Good morning.
And welcome to Great Bridge United Methodist Church. It is a joy to be worshiping with you this morning. And you may have heard we are in the height of flu season. So we will continue this week with our greeting time. We can do air hugs, we can elbow, we can do a little wave. But don't be offended if someone doesn't want a hug this morning. So let us greet one another with Christian love and fellowship.
Thank you.
Show, sir. Speak up. There you go.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I'm not asking any volunteers like I did last time. Well, I welcome you here today to Super Sunday.
Oh. Amen.
No, this is Super Sunday because there's no bowl here because there's no losers. There's only winners, winners for God here today. And for those who are watching on broadcast, this is protected under the rights of the LGL. That's the Love God. We're here today, love God. So let's begin by standing and doing our call to worship. Almighty God of yesterday, today, and tomorrow, do not be silent, but speak that we may hear.
See justice that we may correct our lawlessness. See righteousness that we may know your ways. See compassion that we may know your mercy. See abundance that we may serve others. See understanding that we may be peacemakers. See glory.
Forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace when we speak our shortcomings.
We speak of mistakes we have made. We speak of abandoning your ways. We speak of failures to show compassion and mercy. We speak of our need for forgiveness.
Mighty One of yesterday, today, and tomorrow, hear our prayer and lead us into fullness of life. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 339, Our Sinners to the Gospel Feast. Hope and love, and you respond in unexpected ways. We ask that you use these offerings to share Jesus' healing through love and our community. Thank you, God. Amen.
Good wins out in the end.
So as people of faith, the ideas of hopes and forces of good being stronger than evil are not new to us. It's the hope we have in Jesus Christ, and through this hope in Christ that we believe the truth prevails, that good will always conquer evil. So last week, Pastor Tim reminded us that in the wake of evil, that we have people. People who have suffered and been hurt by sin and evil. People who are in need of hope. People who are desperate for the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's in this state of desperation that we find ourselves entering the story of Jesus today, in today's scripture passage, as we hear of a man whose life was diminished by the forces of his time. It is a story where the hope of one encountered the power of the one that opened the eyes of communities to the force that was preparing to transform the world, the force of Jesus Christ. So let us hear this story as it is written in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 40 through 45. A man with a skin disease approached Jesus, fell to his knees, and begged, "If you want, you can make me clean." Incensed, Jesus reached out his hand, touched him, and said, "I do want to. Be clean." Instantly, the skin disease left him, and he was clean. Sternly, Jesus sent him away, saying, "Don't say anything to anyone. Instead, go and show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifice for your cleansing that Moses commanded. This will be a testimony to them." Instead, he went out and started talking freely and spreading the news so that Jesus wasn't able to enter a town openly. He remained outside in deserted places, but people came to him from everywhere. Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward at this time.
More than he fears contagious diseases.
Help us to learn
how to do the same thing.
some sort of bad cold or respiratory infection already this year. Anyone out there? That is a lot of hands. And now how many people have not had the flu yet and are trying to not get the flu?
Amen.
That's even more hands. So for all of you who haven't had the flu yet, have you been doing anything crazy trying to not get sick? Like maybe wearing a mask? Maybe carrying hand sanitizer around? We can do some pretty crazy things, can't we, to keep ourselves from getting sick. Now for this part, you don't need to raise your hands because it does involve a bit of confession. If you have been sick, have you ever gone to work or other events, maybe even church, knowing that you might be sick, maybe even contagious, and that you shouldn't be out? Why do we do this? Why do we strive so hard to avoid being sick? And then, yeah, when we're sick, we often go out and expose others to illness. I think part of the reason why we do that is because while there are physical ailments when we're sick, that discomfort and the aches and pains, we don't want to be disconnected from our community and our life. The community and our life that we have come to love and depend on for support. And after all, getting sick can sometimes be scary. Illnesses can have significant impacts on our lives. And depending on a number of factors in someone's life, from being chronically ill or work deadlines or being a single parent, getting sick with something even as simple as a flu or cold virus can have significant consequences for their life. I think this is one of the themes that we see in today's scripture passage, where a leper asks Jesus to heal him. We see in this passage that not only is it a text about physical healing, but it is also a text with spiritual applications for both the man and the community. You see, having leprosy in the first century was profoundly life-changing, not only because of the physical suffering that one underwent, but because they ultimately became totally disconnected from their community. We can come to understand this better when we think about the Hebrew word that is often used and translated as leprosy in our scripture, the word zaraat. Zaraat includes the disease leprosy as we understand it today, but it also includes a wide range of skin conditions, everything from boils and burns to bald patches to sores and rashes on the skin. We first see this Hebrew word being used in Exodus when God provided Moses with two signs to prove to elders that he was a prophet from God. And one of those signs was with his hand being afflicted with leprosy, and then God healing it. Leprosy and being healed of it was so significant that God used it as a sign to prove that Moses was a prophet. But unlike Moses, to live as a leper in first century Israel, one was essentially living death because you were labeled as being unclean. And being labeled as unclean by a priest meant that you were excluded from the community. You were excluded from participating in the life of the community and your religious community. This exclusion went so far that you were even required to live outside the bounds of the city, beyond the city boundaries. And because leprosy was considered to be highly contagious, lepers were legally required to yell, "Unclean, unclean," so that others would avoid contact with them. Lepers were also required to follow a strict schedule of checking in with the priest, so the priest could determine whether or not they were clean or unclean, had they experienced healing, and what actions were necessary. This all sounds like a pretty humiliating life experience, doesn't it? For something as simple as getting sick. But I think it helps us understand why one would have been so scared to get leprosy. Because they lived within a system that exercised both wisdom in preventing the spread of disease, but also exercised exclusion. Exclusion to the point where people who were sick became outcasts. How painful it must have been to experience life as a leper. Not only did you experience the physical pain of the illness, but the emotional and spiritual pain that came hand in hand with your sickness. And as I reflected on this text, I wondered, while as awful as the physical condition was, if it wasn't people's fear, fear of the non-physical consequences, fear of being completely disconnected from your life, that caused them to be so afraid of getting sick. As bad as it was to experience the skin afflictions, experiencing humiliation and being ignored, being looked at with fear and contempt and disgust day after day, were probably far worse than any symptom they could experience. And in the rare occasion when a leper was actually healed, their experience of social and emotional and spiritual wounds and hurts remained with them. And I think it's this reality that makes both the actions of the leper and Jesus unique in today's passage. You see, the leper's action of approaching Jesus and speaking words other than unclean, were a direct breach of the law. And in doing this, the leper took actions that were bold and faithful as he approached the one who revealed the greatest hope to him for his future. And at the same time, Jesus's actions were bold and spoke volumes, not only through his word, but in his action as he reached out his hand and touched the leper. And in that moment of touching the leper, he entered the leper's pain and was journeying with him in his suffering without fear. And he communicated to him, "I do want to. I want to heal you. I want to be with you in this moment. I want to walk beside you in your suffering." And in that moment, Jesus said, "Be clean." And the leper was healed immediately. He was healed physically, but Jesus also healed his soul as the leper's relationships in his community and with his friends and family were restored. And I think it must have been a joyous occasion where the leper was rejoicing. And I believe that that's why he did listen to Jesus' command, and he went out in the community to share the good news of his healing and the good news of Jesus. And that is a lesson for us. So many times in our life, we can be experiencing situations that cause us to feel separated from people we love, separated from our families and our communities, separated from life, from people who are closest to us. And in those times when we are suffering from illness, suffering spiritually and emotionally, we often want to cry out to God, if you choose. If you choose, God, to heal me. If you choose, God, to speak to me and answer my prayers. But I also wonder if we sometimes stop short of crying out to God. If we stop short in fear. Fear that maybe we won't hear the answer that we long for from God. Fear that maybe God won't answer us at all. Fear that God's answer may be different than what we hope for. I think the answer for us, though, is in the leper. The leper who had the faith and the courage to encounter the one, who had the power to change his life, Jesus Christ. And in his vulnerability, the leper opened himself up to something that was far greater than himself and his suffering. The leper opened himself up to the love and grace of Jesus Christ and the power it had to transform him and make him whole. You see, in that moment when Jesus reached out and said, I want to, Jesus met the leper right where he was at. In all of his brokenness, in all of his sickness, in all of his suffering, in all of the places in his life that were unclean. And Jesus brought light to that darkness. And that, my friend, is what Jesus does in our lives. Jesus brings light to all those places in our life where we are suffering. Suffering physically, suffering emotionally, suffering spiritually. Those places that we are afraid to show anyone else, and sometimes afraid to show God. Jesus meets us where we are at and brings us healing and makes us whole again. And when we experience that love and grace, when we begin to experience restoration in our life, in our relationships, in our communities, we begin to experience the kingdom of God right here on earth. We begin to experience that peace that surpasses understanding. And it is in that time and space when Jesus meets us where we're at that we ultimately find healing. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
found on page 12 in your Kindle, with the sum and responses on page 17. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and each other. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymns. The body of Christ redeemed by his blood. by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes again in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Thank you. decoy.
Closing hymn.
God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. Well, see, I don't think you can rest on our judgment.
Yes.
But even if we were